Pritam Mondal, and I am currently studying in IIM Trichy. I am creating this video for IEP course and going to talk about poverty, which is an important economic issue currently faced by our country. India's government is well aware that poverty is a giant barrier to overcome if it is to fully develop the nation. A wide range of anti-poverty policies have been introduced since the 1950s, which nonetheless took effect after 20 years of implementation. If the decline in poverty went from 60% to 35% between the 1970s, and the early 1990s, globalization and liberalization policies have made this trend go backward in the 90s. The poverty in India is measured by a poverty line that is probably one of the most disputed and incessantly attacked measure in the world. What's more, the World Bank's controversial poverty line has its origin in the Indian model. It is simply what some call a starvation line, a line that accounts for the feeling of safety measured in calories. Now, some of the statistics of the poverty in India are: 50% of India don't have proper shelter. 70% of the Indians don't have access to decent toilets. 85% of the villages don't have a secondary school. Over 40% of these villages don't have proper roads connecting them. In 2009-10, according to the 66th round of NSS survey, 29.6%, or in absolute numbers, 360 million people were still living below the poverty line. Current estimations of the number of people below the poverty line vary from 20 to 50% of the population. From conservatives to liberals' estimations, precisely because of the debate around the Indian poverty line, the idea is that recognizing either 240 million or 600 million poor means radically different policies for a government. So clearly the stakes are high for the parties representing richer segments of the population. To sum up, government in India has relied on two approaches to alleviate poverty in India. The first approach is based on the thinking that benefit of economic growth will trickle down to the poor in the long run, and if higher rate of economic growth is achieved, it will result in removal of poverty. Of the post-independent reforms that has achieved the most in terms of reducing poverty in India, land reform gets the winning prize. But if they had actually redistributed the land, they could have really eradicated one of the causes of poverty in India. On the other hand, you could argue that at least limited land reforms have served as the second best solution. 1991 is the year India embraced globalization and started, like many other countries, its market liberalization coupled with privatization and deregulation while ensuring macroeconomic stability. Where China has been one of the few countries that has successfully managed their transition to the global market, the picture is more mixed with India, with lots of ups and downs. As a consequence, people are commonly opposed to privatization and liberalization. However, it may have been better to adopt more a progressive and thorough approach to reform. Overall, the opening of Indian markets to the world did over the years contribute to reduce poverty in India by raising the income of a large number of people and opening access to education to many. Liberalizing the system of exports, imports and trade, along with the development of higher education in larger cities, have been the major factor leading to the rise of the middle class and reduction of urban poverty in India. Trade reforms and education should penetrate all layers of society if poverty is to be tackled substantially. As over 2/3 of the population lives in rural areas, public investment should focus on developing agriculture and basic infrastructure. The private sector will be more than happy to invest and trade with new regions, but not as long as they are unprofitable or inaccessible. And that is the role of the state, to provide at least the most basic infrastructure and roads to connect villages. Therefore, in this approach, emphasis was laid exclusively in attaining a higher economic growth to eradicate poverty. After 1980, it was realized that it will take a long time for economic growth, even the higher one, that will cause reduction in poverty. Therefore, according to the second approach, in the short run, until economic growth alleviates poverty, significantly special anti-poverty schemes such as National Rural Employment Scheme, the NGNRES, providing food subsidies to the poor through public distribution system. Whether economic growth necessarily reduces poverty has been a controversial issue. As pointed above, it was first generally believed that benefits of economic growth would trickle down to the poor and thus alleviate poverty in the economy. This trickle-down effect of economic growth was thought to operate through an increase in the employment opportunities and rise in real wages as a result of increase in productivity of workers. The favorable employment effect of economic growth depends on employment elasticity of output growth. The rise in real wages was thought to occur as a result of rise in wages of workers employed in the agriculture and non-agricultural sector, both organized and informal. The agricultural growth was visualized to cause reduction in food prices and greater availability of food grains, along with employment growth in agriculture. This would ensure reduction of poverty as it would enable the poor to meet their minimum consumption requirements. Besides, in this approach, it was thought that the poor will also be benefited by the multiplier effect of economic growth. According to this, benefits of growth are reaped first by the rich and subsequently by the poor when the rich spends their income, leading to the rise in income and employment for the poor. Further, as explained by T. N. Srinivasan, the multiplier effect also operates to economic growth, raising the revenue of government, which, if invested in public goods and services, which are relatively consumed more by the poor, would reduce non-income effects of poverty, such as reduction in infant mortality rate and rise in life expectancy of the poor. Further, some Indian economists, especially Professor Jagdish Bhagwati and Arvind Panagriya of Columbia University, have argued that economic growth leads to the increase in revenue of the government, which can be spent on special anti-poverty scheme. This will help in reducing poverty. The policy of economic reforms of liberalization, privatization, and globalization has no doubt generated higher economic growth, but its impact on the poverty has been very little, as it has benefited the rich more. In this context, it is interesting to note that while the state of Bihar, which achieved the highest growth of 10% during the period 2004-5 to 2019, decline in poverty ratio was estimated to decline negligibly during the period. This implies that achievement of higher economic growth is not enough. Much depends on the character of economic growth regarding whether growth strategy is pro-poor or pro-rich. The higher rate of economic growth can help in reducing poverty significantly if it is employment-oriented and involves human resource development of the poor, lowers inflation, especially food inflation, institutional charges to redistribute productive assets, such as implementation of land reforms in agriculture, the greater priority to build up, which is a large multiplier effect. Such a pro-poor growth strategy has not been pursued in India.